Thank you.
So up next is Jonathan Frazer and Mafalda Dias. Their talk's titled Disease Variant Prediction with Deep Generative Models of Evolutionary Data. And so Mafalda and Jonathan are senior postdocs in Deborah Mark's group at Harvard Medical School. They work at the intersection of computational biology and machine learning, where they develop probabilistic models of sequence data with an emphasis on predicting risk of disease from this genetic variation. So if you're ready to go, take it away.
Can you see my cursor?
Yep.
Great. Well, thank you very much for all of you for being here, and thank you for the invitation. So yes, we're going to talk about our latest work that is a computational model for disease variant prediction based on evolutionary sequences, and I'll explain what that means in a second. This is work that was done in collaboration with people in our lab. Deborah Marks is our mentor, but also with the Oxford Machine Learning Group, in particular with Pascal, the PhD student with whom we worked very closely during this project. So the problem we are going to be addressing or asking today is something that I imagine most of us think very deeply about in this AVE alliance. That is, while sequencing is becoming widespread in the clinic for diagnostic and preventive care, our knowledge of the effects of human genetic variation is still very much in its infancy. And just to give you a notion of numbers, even though I'm sure that a lot of you are very familiar with that, out of the 4.6 million missense variants in NOMAD, less than 2% have any clinical interpretation in ClinVar. And this is just missense, not even like the whole picture of human genetic variation. And not only is our knowledge very sparse, but it's also very biased, both in terms of populations, which populations are sequenced, and in terms of which genes are studied. Some are much studied than others. And so sequencing technologies have also helped a lot variant annotation. We now have more ability to do familial and population scale studies in a wider scale. And also, like most of you in the media just was giving a perfect example, there's more and more high throughput functional assays developed specifically for answering this question. But this is a enormous task, and to really make progress in it, we will need multiple different sources of evidence that are, you know, complementary and are scalable across the whole proteome. So what we want to ask in this talk, and what we were asking in our work, is if generative models of sequences across multiple organisms in evolution can help this task. And in a sense, evolutionary conservation is one of the oldest sources of evidence for classifying variants, you know, with the polyfen and SIFT, column conservation across evolution has always been a very used source of evidence. But recently there's been a huge amount of progress in new deep learning models developed specifically for biological sequence data. And these have been shown to be useful for lots of different applications, design, pathogen evolution, structure. And here I'm just showing lots of work from our lab, but this is kind of like an effort from the wider community, and it has been shown to be paying off. So our question is, can this progress translate to the actual problem that we're asking here today of clinical interpretation of human genetic variants? So go ahead. Oh, it's still me, sorry. So the idea is very simple. If we have sequences across different organisms, basically we're looking at constraints from evolution. And if we capture the distribution of the sequences, and this is exactly what we mean by generative model, a model that describes the distribution of the sequences. Here I have P of X. X is the sequences, and theta are just like the parameters of the model. Once we have such generative model that describes this distribution of sequences, where we hope that this model captures all sorts of important patterns that are important for fitness, then we can ask if a new sequence that has a mutation that we haven't seen before, if a new sequence is fit or not fit by being more or less probable according to our model. And our fitness score will therefore be, and we will come back to this ratio over again in this talk, a ratio between the probability of these mutants according to our model in our model versus the probability of the reference sequence in human.
So just explore this idea in a bit more detail. We can start with pretty much the simplest model you can write down, which is going back to this idea of column conservation. So as Mafalda mentioned, this is something with a long history, and you know, we've got this intuition that if we see a multiple sequence alignment and there's an amino acid at a particular position that is highly conserved across distinct organisms, then if we change that amino acid for a very different amino acid, it's likely to disrupt the function of the protein. So what we want to do here is take that intuition and recast it as a probabilistic statement. And one very simple way to do this is to write down a sort of Boltzmann distribution as our model. And then to capture this notion of conservation per site, we just have an energy function, which is a linear sum of terms. So what this Xi denotes here is the presence of amino acid J at position I. And these Hijs basically are a measure of this conservation. So once we have, and then, you know, as my father was saying, we can then score this notion of column conservation as the log odds under the model. Now, once we write the model in this way, this immediately suggests ways to extend the model. So the first thing that might come to mind is going beyond linear order and considering quadratic terms as well. So this is a model with many different names. But Mafalda and I, we come from physics. So for us, this is the Potts model. And this model actually has a very long history in our lab, not for mutation effect prediction, but for structure prediction. Because the reason for this is that if you take the magnitude of these Jij terms and plot them as a function of position, you can make a map like this. And it turns out this map agrees sometimes really quite strikingly with the contact maps that you get from crystal structures. So this model has been used extensively for structure prediction and studying interactions more generally. And if you've heard of AlphaFold, this is a sort of key component of how AlphaFold works as well. However, for this talk, we don't care so much about structure prediction. We just want to study the effects of genetic variations and mutation effect prediction. So how do we compare these two models? How do we decide if this is any kind of improvement over the sort of categorical site-independent model or column conservation model? Well, we just saw one beautiful example in the previous talk, and it's of the deep mutational scans, of which there's now a rapidly growing number. So what we can do is use hundreds of thousands of measurements made in these assays as a way to compare our models and see which ones agree with the experiments the best. So, just as we saw in Medea's talk, we can also make a heat map of the scores. So here, each square represents a different amino acid substitution that's then scored according to this log odds ratio that Mafalda described. And now if we plot the scores from our model against the scores from the experiment, then we can look at sort of the Spearman correlation, and sometimes we get really quite good agreement with the experiments. So to use this as a tool for benchmarking our models, we take just one deep mutational scan. We take as many as we can find. And we compute the Spearman correlation between our models and all of these experiments. And what we see is that the pairwise model consistently outperforms the site-independent model, and sometimes by quite a substantial margin. So this is basically how we reach the conclusion that adding these additional terms really improved our ability to predict the effects of these genetic variations. So if this works, how can we push this idea even further? So you might think, okay, well, if going to quadratic order worked, then let's try going to cubic order. That turned out to not be very fruitful. So in recent years, our lab has kind of moved in a slightly different direction, which is to draw on techniques from deep learning. So our lab is now very active in developing a number of different models, and they have different strengths and weaknesses that are sort of better suited to different downstream tasks. The one we'll focus on today, however, is a model called a variational autoencoder. So the basic idea here is that we acknowledge that sequences are extremely high dimensional objects. So, the configuration space of a multiple sequence alignment goes as 20 to the L, where L is the length of the sequence. So it's some enormous configuration space where we only are ever going to see a tiny, tiny fraction, no matter how large our multiple sequence alignment. So the idea is to make the hypothesis that actually the data can be represented on some lower dimensionals, in some lower dimensional space. And this turns out to be a sort of ubiquitous feature of high dimensional data, that almost all data in nature can be well described in this way. And so what we do here is we say, okay, we're going to imagine that the data is generated by some hidden variable Zi, and it turns out that a sort of 50 dimensional latent space works very well. So we have these 50 hidden latent variables, and they're passed through some nonlinear functions F to form the probabilities AIKL, which are the probabilities of the categorical distribution for which the sequence, the amino acids at a given position are sampled. So to get some intuition about this model, we can think about different limiting cases. So one case is when F is independent of Z, in which case this model just reduces to a categorical distribution per site, and that's just the site-independent model that we started with. So you can think of this model as sort of generalizing the original column conservation model. Another limiting case that you might be familiar with is if F is linear up to a normalization, in which case this is just probabilistic principal component analysis. So another way to think of the model is as a nonlinear generalization of principal component analysis, where now we, instead of F being linear, we allow F to be some general function that we parameterize with a three-layer fully connected neural network, which, as you may have heard, are very general function approximators. So just to explore this idea of principal component analysis a little bit further, what we've plotted here are the first two principal components of this latent representation of the data. So what we have here is each data point corresponds to a sequence in the training set of the model. And this is the multiple sequence alignment for tau protein. And what we see here is that we've colored the data by its sort of fractional Hamming distance. And if we look at all possible single amino acid substitutions, they live in this tiny pink blob here. So this is something that I find really quite remarkable about these models, actually, is that we're training these models on extremely diverse sequences. And yet the task that we're hoping to apply these to is to resolve variations in fitness on the scale of this tiny pink dot here. So this sort of separation in scales is something that I find pretty amazing, that we can get something useful from this at all, actually. Nevertheless, when we benchmark the model using the deep mutational scans, we find that once again, the model consistently outperforms the previous state of the art.
Yeah, so building from this, we asked how can we use these models for asking the question of predicting the clinical effects of genetic variation. And because of what Johnny was just saying, we built from a variational autoencoder. So we optimize a variational autoencoder specifically. We just built a new version that is optimized for the specific question that we have at hand. And out of it, we get these evolutionary index. That's what we call in our model. I should say we call our model the EVE, and I'll refer to it when it comes. In this evolutionary index, however, it's not very easily interpretable, and it's not very easily mappable to some pathogenicity scale, so to say. So on top of the variational autoencoder, we built a different model that is a Gaussian mixture model, where we basically just bin, effectively, all of the variants and the evolutionary indices of the variants into two bins. One of them that we postulate belongs to the benign variants, and the other being that we believe corresponds to the pathogenic variants. So this is kind of like a super simple idea, but out of it, we can basically get a pathogenicity score from 0 to 1, where 1 being just more benign and more pathogenic and 0 less pathogenic, and also a class assignment where we assign each variant to either the pathogenic or the benign class. So one of the things that we're really pleased about, and something that we were looking after when we were building this model, is that we wanted a model that was just based on evolutionary information. And specifically, it is a model that is unsupervised. And what we mean by this, that it does not train on known clinical variant annotations that are known. And this is brings us a handful of benefits. In particular, we sort of avoid some difficulties that are associated with models that have to train on these non-clinical annotations. In particular, it's known that it's very hard to build independent train test sets of data to do a blind and solid validation of your models. So that kind of, with a model that isn't supervised, we sort of avoid this problem. And also we know that these labels are, like I discussed in the beginning, extremely sparse and they are noisy and biased. So it's also problematic to build models that train on those. So basically we kind of avoid these difficulties by having a model that's purely unsupervised. So we applied this model to 3,200 proteins that we know are involved in disease. And these are our AUCs computed on what we call current known labels. That's just like annotations from clean var, benign and pathogenic annotations from clean var. So our average AUC is 0.92. And you can see that there is some noise that is related to proteins that have very small number of labels for validation. And so we also plot here the results only for the proteins that have more than 10 labels known on clean var. Another thing that we can get out of our model, because we have these class assignment, the classification of variants into the benign or pathogenic clusters, because this model is probabilistic, we have a natural metric for uncertainty in this class assignment. And therefore we have a certain trade-off between how much accuracy we want out of our predictions versus how many variants we are classifying. So if we give predictions or class assignments for all the variants in our proteins, we are basically making predictions to 36 million variants, and we have an accuracy of about 85%. But if we take our most uncertain class assignments as uncertain and we don't classify them as benign or pathogenic, then you can see that we can increase our accuracy and we just give predictions for less variants. In particular, if we take a cutoff of, if we choose an accuracy of about 90%, that corresponds to setting as uncertain 25% of our predictions. This corresponds to, in terms of numbers, just to give you an idea. So this number for variants of unknown significance is based on what is seen in NOMAD and UK Biobank. And these are the existing clinical labels in ClinVar. And if we take these 90% accuracy thresholds, what we get are these sort of like predictions from our model. In practice, we don't really expect, we don't really think that there's anything very deep about an accuracy of 90% or throwing away 25% of our most uncertain variants. And we expect the users of our model to choose this uncertainty threshold in a per gene basis. And in fact, we've been working now with Invitae, which are thinking of using this model as part of their classification pipeline. And we're discussing with them using this in a more, you know, more curated way, a more refined way, where basically this uncertainty threshold is picked on a per gene basis.
So we also benchmarked the model, the method against other computational models. And what we have here are, if the circle is filled, then it's other unsupervised methods. And if the open circles, then these are supervised methods. We compared the model using two benchmarks, clinical labels. So, AUCs against benign and pathogenic labels in ClinVar, and then concordance with deep mutational scans using Spearman correlation. And what was a very nice surprise for us was that we outperformed even supervised methods on this ClinVar benchmark. And this was surprising to us because, these methods use the labels during training. So it makes sense that they would be particularly strong at this task. But for the reasons that my father described, we were very keen to be unsupervised so that this could be sort of treated as a independent source of evidence in sort of variant classification pipelines. So, we were not expecting to actually outperform these other methods on this particular task, in part because the benchmark includes labels that are used during training. So there's a certain circularity here. which is partly why we use the second benchmark of deep mutational scans. And so we took the set that we described before, and we restricted our attention to ones where the papers were directly seeking to do the same task as us, so trying to find evidence for the clinical interpretation of the variants. And I think with this, we have something like 12 or 14 assays. So it's a smaller set, but it doesn't suffer from the same circularity as this ClinVar benchmark. And it's nice to see that on this benchmark, we do better as well. And I think it's worth noting that other unsupervised methods also seem to sort of creep up through the rankings as on this other benchmark, which I think is interesting.
Yes, so far we were talking about using deep mutational scans almost like a ground truth that we just use as a, we compare against to see how well we perform at predicting the results from deep mutational scans. But these deep mutational scans are also developed to predict the clinical effect. So a different question that we can ask is, how does our performance at predicting the clinical effects in humans compare to the performance of deep mutational scans at predicting the effects of mutants, the clinical effects of mutation in humans? And so these are results for P53. So in this plot here, this is position in protein space and in sequence space. And all of these dots correspond to ClinVar labels, and the crosses to VUS is based on UK Biobank and Nomad. And red crosses and blue crosses are just our predictions at this 90% accuracy threshold. So you can see, so here are our if scores, and these are the experimental scores from the Giacomelli et al. Assay. And what we can see here is that our AUC is actually slightly higher here, but when we look at multiple different experiments, what we conclude is that our model performs on par to high throughput assays. And we were very excited about this because in a sense, it just brings to the idea that these two completely independent sources of evidence, so evolutionary evidence and high throughput assays, functional assays, can be brought together, and they can be built on each other. And actually, this is something that we are very excited about, and we reach out to you. We've been thinking about how interesting and exciting it would be to build experimental design informed from these computational methods, and improving our computational methods back from the experiments, etc. This is a direction that we're very much excited about. So please reach out if you're interested. Right. So just to finish off, we put all our results on our server, evmodel.org, that we encourage you to go and see. So our idea is that, so we only have currently the results for 3,200 proteins, but we are constantly updating the website with more results. And hopefully we hope to have results for the whole proteome. If there's something that you don't see there and you're particularly interested about, just reach out to us and we'll run it. And this is the kind of stuff that you can download. You can download like heat maps, like the ones that Mireille and Johnny were talking about, and also our scores, etc.
That brings us to the end. So just to summarize, this task of annotating all possible variants is a huge task, even if we restrict it to missense variants. And overcoming this problem is going to involve sort of multiple scalable and orthogonal sources of evidence. So really the goal of this work was to revisit in some ways a very old idea of using evolutionary data as a source of evidence, but now, bringing sort of modern or recent developments in deep learning. And what we find is that actually this is a surprisingly strong or compelling source of evidence for variant annotation. And we hope this will be useful in variant classification moving forwards. However, I think we're also at a very early stage with this. I think we can get much more, we can learn much more about disease from sequencing diverse organisms than we are currently doing. And also I think, these models are still in rapid development. So I think there's a lot of room for improvement still. So with that, I just wanna thank our lab. I think, everybody works on very different problems, but the methods are common across these diverse tasks. So I think we all work very closely in developing the methods. And Debbie has, was very hands-on in this project. So she's been a fantastic mentor to us and also collaborator. So yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, so thank you, Johnny and Mafalda. I'll give it some time for people who are interested. You can type your questions now into the Q&A function and I'll read them aloud. While we wait, I had one quick question. When you showed the plot of the AUC values for the different, when you were benchmarking it to the like no invariance, did you notice anything about the genes where the model wasn't doing so well? Like, might we be able to infer anything about the evolution of those genes? Like, if your model's performing very poorly, might that be informative about that gene, or what might that mean?
Right.
Yeah, I mean, this is something we're really interested in. I don't think we have a clear answer at this stage. One thing we expected going into this project is that it was going to be heavily dependent on the depth of the alignment, whether or not the model would perform well, but that turns out not to be the case. There's great examples, there's good models or very good models with quite shallow alignments, and there's others that are extremely deep. So that didn't turn out to be the case, which is good news. But we've basically got a set of genes where the model performs less well that we're currently exploring, especially with Invite. And it's still unclear what the pattern is.
That's very interesting. So we have a few questions here. So first, Jacob Kitzman has said, great talk and paper. We've noticed that the deep mutational scans and algorithmic predictions agree very well for no invariance. For example, the ClinVar multiple submitters, but are much less concordant beyond those sites. Can you provide some intuition for this contrast, especially for an unsupervised model like Eve?
I'm quite surprised by that. So it would be great because it is an unsupervised model. So in principle, it should be independent of that. So it would be great if we could talk about this, actually, if Jacob could share it with us. Yeah. Don't know if you have anything else to say on that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So Grant Goldman asks, in the plot where the first two components of Z are shown, does the distance from human sequence recapitulate phylogenetic distance?
Loosely speaking, that's pretty much the main structure of the latent space. It does indeed closely resemble phylogeny. Yeah. This is always kind of a tantalizing question for us, is like, what other information can we extract from the latent representations? And it's a very active area of research in the lab. It's something controllable and manipulatable, which is, I think, exciting. So it's particularly, so for a start, you can do various things to the model to force different latent representations. And I think there's a lot that can be done with that. It's particularly, I mean, perhaps the most obvious approach though is a semi-supervised method. So this is something that particularly the people interested in protein design do, is they use semi-supervised methods where the supervision allows you to sort of force certain structure onto the latent representation that, you know, correlates with particular properties that you're interested in for design. I think there's much more to be explored here.
Great. And so there's one more question from Mike Pazin, where he's saying that it's exciting work and congratulations on your Nature paper, of course. So he wants to know, does Eve performance correlate with particular protein functions, for example, transcription factors, kinases, or receptors, or protein folds?
Well, exactly what is the fitness we are capturing with evolution? It's an interesting topic of discussion. So what the model captures is fitness for the organism. And actually, when we, like Tony described, we use extensively in our lab deep mutational scans almost as like a benchmark for our models, for how well we're beyond the human problem, so in general. And this is a question that we are always thinking, is the assay, this is a functional, this function that is being probed by the assay relevant to the fitness we are trying to capture? And sometimes actually it's quite interesting. It turns out that if the specific DMS is studying two different functions, sometimes it turns out that our score correlates better with some sort of like average of these two of the two scores, if you see what I mean. Like a particular assay was a V-core, yeah, right? V-core. That they study abundance and activity, and it turns out that the method, I don't know exactly which method they were looking into, probably some pairwise model, correlated better with the two scores, and the scores correlated with each other, which kind of tells you that these evolutionary scores are capturing both functions, and both functions are important for the fitness of this protein, according to the model. But yeah, it's an interesting point that we sort of like, yeah, come back to over again.
Great. So I think we have time for this last question. So Fritz Roth has said, very exciting work. And he's pointing out that one smart thing that your group did was only report scores for the variants where you were most confident. And then you benchmarked your performance against other methods for these scores. And what he's curious about is whether other methods do this and how might your conclusions change if you compare your results to the favorite variants of these other methods.
Right. So yeah, that's an important point. So that's not how we do the benchmarking. That's how we recommend the usage of the model. So here, you know, Mafalda talked about, you know, using different uncertainty cutoffs to, you know, to classify the variants. But when we compare against, well, for start, an AUC has no cutoff. It's independent of cutoff. So that's why it's a good quantity to use for comparing methods, because it is independent of any decision about what is the most appropriate cutoff for the method. The downside, of course, is that, you know, maybe the cutoff really improves the performance, but you miss out on that, of course. And the same with Spearman's. So again, we don't remove any variants from the benchmarking when we compute Spearman's. We score everything. So again, it's just an intrinsic property of the model that is independent of the cutoff.
Perfect. Thank you very much.
Okay, so I think that's it for the Q&A. And thank you, everybody, for coming. Thank you to all of our speakers. I wanted to give a quick reminder that there will be no seminar planned for January. Our next session is scheduled for February 1st. So thanks again for everyone for attending, and hopefully everybody has a good holidays.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.